Hello there, this is Talking Europe on France 24. I'm Catherine Nicholson. Now, earlier on this week, the United Nations General Assembly opened with, amid other pretty dire talk about the state of the global order right now, a warning from the Secretary General of the United Nations that we are in a, quote, suicidal war against nature.
The battle we must end, our suicidal war against nature. The climate crisis is the defining issue of our time, and it must be the first priority of every government and multilateral organization. And yet, climate action is being put on the back burner, despite overwhelming public support around the world. Global greenhouse gas emissions need to be slashed by 45% by 2030 to have any hope of reaching net zero emissions by 2050. And yet, emissions are going up at record levels, on course to a 14% increase this decade. We have a rendezvous with climate disaster.
Well, the European Union's various leaders have spelled out that they want the bloc to be a champion for climate. But given those words by Antonio Guterres, we're asking today whether that really is the case. Now, with me on the line from Dortmund in Germany, MEP Peter Liese from the European People's Party Group in the European Parliament. And he's the person who's leading negotiations for the European Parliament on a key element of its climate policy, the European Union's carbon market, the carbon emissions trading. He's also a member of the Environment Committee at the Parliament. Mr. Liese, thank you very much for being with us today.
It's a pleasure.
Well, let's start off with those words from the United Nations Secretary General. He fears that the world is backsliding on its climate commitments. This summer, we saw historic droughts here in Europe, unprecedented forest fires, for example, in parts of Brittany, which are known for being kind of cold and damp usually, for example. Is this all a sign that we actually do need more decisive climate action?
Yes, definitely. And I'm very grateful that Antonio Guterres made this point. We need to act this summer all over Europe and in many places in the world. It made again clear that the climate crisis is not stopping. We have other challenges with the war in Ukraine. We should stop financing the Russian war. And we have a big problem with prices. But we need to do measures that address all the three problems at the same time.
Well, this summer, there was a bit of a testy time in the European Parliament, which I'm sure you remember, where there were votes on laws about reforming the EU's carbon market. These laws, of course, aimed at curbing climate change. Now, critics said that the package that was finally voted, a compromise deal, is not going to get Europe to meet the crucial target set out in the Paris Agreement of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees above pre-industrialization levels by the end of this century. What was the success of this package in that case?
So what we adopted in the European Parliament is even more ambitious than the proposal of the European Commission. It will bring us for a reduction that is higher than 55% compared to 1990. And we are the only big economy globally that will bring such a reduction. You know, we have to applaud Joe Biden, what he does in the United States, but it falls, of course, short compared to the European approach. Not only that he's only committing 50%, but when you look at per capita emissions and the base year, the US will still have 2.5 times more per capita emissions in 2050, even if Biden is successful. That shows how ambitious the European Union is. And the challenge is to bring others to the table and to make them to increase the efforts. That's why the United Nations as a forum is so important.
I just want to come back, though, to that that claim from members of the Green Group, for example, that this package is not going to help Europe to meet its Paris Agreement commitment of that 1.5 degree temperature rise limit. Do you agree with that assessment?
No, I strongly disagree. The 1.5 degrees target is a global target, and everybody needs to contribute. Europe has reduced the emissions by 25% compared to 1990. All other major economies, not only China, but also United States, Australia, Japan, have increased their emissions. So we are in a situation where would the United States and Australia only apply what Europe applies only today, we would be much further. So you cannot say that Europe is not doing enough. We have a big challenge to go to 55% or even to 57 or 58, mm-hmm. as the European Parliament has decided, isn't easy. And we should concentrate on bringing that target to the ground and not speaking permanently about higher targets. And we should concentrate on the global efforts.
Just in terms of how the vote was received among environmental groups, so not politicians, the Worldwide Fund for Nature was not entirely happy about the outcome. They say that the Parliament caved into industry lobbying on this issue. It is true that there's been very intense lobbying around this. Would you agree that the lobbyists did win the day somewhat?
There is, of course, a lot of lobbying because it's the biggest climate law that we decided ever. It has consequences for every individual person, but also for any company, all the jobs. But the lobbying of environmental NGOs was also intensive, and it is welcome. As the chief negotiator for the Parliament, I talk to everybody, and it is necessary to get the perspective of everybody. And to be honest, you cannot just exclude the question of jobs. Now, if we decarbonize in Europe and we don't have any industry in Europe because we are putting too much pressure on industry, nobody will follow us. Why should the Chinese and the Japanese and the Indians follow Europe when we lose all our industry? That's why we need to be on a path where we not deindustrialize Europe, mm-hmm. but decarbonize our industry. And that's why the balance is also important for the global climate and not only for the jobs in Europe.
Now, just looking at something else that was brought up at the United Nations General Assembly about how we pay for these for everything, for the climate change policies. Obviously, as you know, the European Commission recently announced that it's bringing in a so-called solidarity contribution, in essence, a windfall tax on energy companies benefiting from the spike in energy prices due to sanctions on Russia. And this contribution is going to be used to help ordinary people and businesses with their energy costs this winter. At the UN General Assembly, Antonio Guterres called for a similar windfall tax, but in order to help pay to combat climate change. Would you welcome this idea?
I think both is necessary. In the proposals that we adopted in the European Parliament in June, we have included the idea that the revenues from the emission trading that member states have, and the revenues are quite high now because the ETS price is higher, that part of it should go to developing countries. I think this is key for the Conference of the Parties in Egypt that happens in November, mm-hmm. because we will only unite the world if those that are really in need, African countries, for example, will be supported by the industrialized countries. And we need to do more here because it's just, but also because it's the only possibility to get an agreement, because all these countries need to support any agreement. So, and if they see that we are only polluting and they are only suffering, there will not be an agreement.
In terms of the idea of a windfall tax, we've heard another European country that's not an EU member, the new Prime Minister of the UK, Liz Truss, she has rejected the idea of a windfall tax, either for use in energy costs or climate change. Her reasoning being that it will stifle investment by energy companies in renewables. What do you make of that argument?
Yeah, I think we need to be careful. And that's why the European Commission didn't suggest that we capture all the so-called windfall profits, because if you exaggerate, you will take money away from those companies that need to invest in renewable energies. But the profits are so high that part of it can be captured, and that's why I support the idea of the European Commission. And also, if part of the money would go to developing countries, that would help the global agenda.
And just one final question for you. As I said in the beginning, the European Union's various leaders have talked about the bloc as being a leader for the world on climate change. At this point in time, is this the case?
Yes, but we can do more. So the European Parliament's position would bring the ambition up to 58% in 2030. And that would be another signal. You know, there are individual countries that have also quite strong commitments, but the big polluters, China, United States, Australia, Japan, have less ambitious targets. And that's why Europe is a leader in fighting against climate change.
Peter Liese, thank you so much for being with us today for Talking Europe.
It's a pleasure.
And thanks to you for watching as well. Hope to see you again very soon here on France 24.